Hi, hello everyone. My name is Ramchandra Reddy. You are watching ChemTuber. You see, today we are going to discuss about the p-block elements, 15th and 16th group. Particularly 15, 16s are the properties where I will compare here. Main, what are the properties, elements, what are the periodic trends, hydrates, bond length, stability order, acidic nature, basic nature, oxidation states. All this I will compare in this video. Okay, let us talk about the first basic points. The p block elements, particularly I am talking about the 15 16. First property, elements. What are the elements in 15th group? Nitrogen, phosphorus, arsenic, antimony, bismuth. Here nitrogen, phosphorus are said to be non metals. These two are non metals, and arsenic, antimony are said to be metalloids. Bismuth is a typical metal. Bismuth is only a metal, whereas in this same oxygen, sulfur are said to be non-metals, and selenium, tellurium are said to be metalloids, and polonium is a metal and it is a radioactive substance. Radioactive. We don't have any radioactive element in the 15th group. In 16th group we have one particular element. Now, common oxidation states. What are the common oxidation states here? If you remember the common oxidation states, first you should know the electronic configuration. What is the outermost electronic configuration of 15th group? NH2NP3. How we got -3 here? NH2NP3 all together it contains 5 electrons. To get stable, it has to gain 3 electrons. So, if it gain 3 electrons, electronic configuration gain 3 electron, what we get? -3, right? Already in NH2NP3 how many electrons are there? 5 electrons are there. To become stability, it has to gain 3 electron. If it gain 3 electron, it becomes -3. Then how it become +3? Outermost electron, it has 3 electrons in p orbital. If it lose 3 electrons completely, loss of 3 electron, what we get here? +3. Loss of 3 electron, we get +3. What about +5? If it lose 5 electron, loss of 5 electrons, what we get here? +5. Okay, so understood this point. Valency configuration, outermost configuration is NH2NP3, total 5 electrons are there. To get stability, it has to lose 3 electrons. If it lose 3 electron, we get +3. Sorry, to get stability, it has to gain 3 electron. If it gain 3 electrons, we get +3. If it lose 3 electrons in outermost, like only in p orbital, 3 electrons, we get +3. If it lose complete electron, NH2NP3, 5 electrons if it lose, it becomes +5. So, that way you can remember -3, +3, +5 are common oxygen states of 15th group elements. Coming to 16th. 16th group elements, outermost configuration is what? NH2NP4. So, all together it has 6 electrons. To get stability, it has to lose 2 electron. So, it has to gain 3 electron. If it gain 2 electron, gaining of 2 electron, we get -2. But I am not writing -2 because all the elements, oxygen, sulfur, selenium, tellurium, polonium, all these elements cannot gain 2 electron. Okay. So, commonly we cannot write that oxidation number. So, +4 I can write because after losing 4 electron, loss of 4 electron, we get +4 oxidation states. Similarly, if it lose 6 electron altogether, loss of 6 electron, it becomes +6. And which can exist -2? Oxygen mainly. Oxygen is very important, which can exist -2. But there are some exceptions. Oxygen not only -2, in some compounds like OF2, O2F2, it can exist different oxidation states. If you take this OF2, what is the oxidation number here? +2 will get. In O2F2, +1. In particularly these two elements, OF2, O2F2, oxygen is +2 in OF2, oxygen +1 in O2F2. You know the reason, because comparing to oxygen, fluorine more electronegative. If it is a more electronegative, oxygen become -1. I write it here, you try to understand. OF2, I want want to find out oxygen oxidation number. Oxygen, suppose I don't know x, 2 into fluorine is minus 1 is equal to 0, x is equal to what? 2 I get, so I return 2. Similarly, O2F2, in O2F2, oxygen I don't know, let us take 2x, 2 into minus 1 is equal to 0, x is equal to plus 1, so that's why I return plus 1. Okay, so oxygen here, oxidation number in OF2, O2F2 particularly, plus 2 and plus 1 oxidation state, that is the exception case. Remaining R&R, it can exist the minus 2 oxidation number. Next, coming here, stability order of oxidation states. Out of this minus 3, plus 5, plus 3, along the, down the group, all the elements cannot form minus 3 and plus 5, plus 3. Particular elements, stability will be different. Like, suppose if I take the minus 3, minus 3 stability order down the group decreases. Means, nitrogen can form minus 3, that becomes stable. But remaining elements, phosphorus, arsenic, antimony, bismuth, they cannot able to form minus 3. I written here minus 3 stability oxidation number decreased down the group. Why it is decreased down the group? Minus 3 oxidation states mean it has to gain 3 electron. To get 3 electron down the group, metallic nature increases here. Metal will not gain electron. The tendency of metal always to lose electron. And that's the point. Minus 3 oxidation number is more stable for nitrogen but not for remaining elements. The reason is nitrogen can gain 3 electron easily, it can exist minus 3. Remaining elements cannot gain 3 electron easily because remaining elements down the group metallic nature increases. When metallic nature increases, they cannot able to gain electron, they can lose electron. And that's why plus 3 oxidation number increases. Down the group metallic nature increases. When metallic nature increases, electron losing tendency increases. If electron losing tendency increases, bismuth can form plus 3 stable compound. Bismuth stable in plus 3 form. Whereas nitrogen cannot form plus 3, it is unstable. Even if it form, it is unstable molecule. And plus 5 decreases. Means bismuth cannot able to form plus 5, it is unstable. Because down the group plus 5 oxidation state always decreases. So the point is very clear. Minus 3 decreases because all elements cannot gain 3 electron to exhibit minus 3. Plus 3 increases because all elements cannot lose 3 electron also to get plus 3. Which elements can gain electron? Which elements can lose electron? Non-metals can gain electrons. Metals lose electrons. Okay. So non-metals like nitrogen, phosphorus, they can gain electrons, so they can exhibit minus 3. Metals, they can lose electron. Bismuth is a metal, so it lose electron, it can form plus 3. That way, remember. And coming to here, minus 2 plus 6. Minus 2 oxidation state decreases. Plus 6 is decreases. Minus 2 oxidation number, why it is decreases? To exhibit minus 2 oxidation number, it has to gain electron. Gain 2 electron. Which elements gain electron? Non-metals. So, beginning oxygen, sulfur, they have minus 2 electron. So, oxygen minus 2 is stable. Remaining elements it cannot form minus, that down the group it is a decrease. And plus 4 oxidation number increases due to inert-to-pair effect. Inert-to-pair effect. So here also I can write due to inert-to-pair effect. So I hope all of you know the inert-to-pair effect. That the inert-to-pair effect means the outermost NS2 electron become inert due to attractions from the nucleus due to poor shielding of the f orbitals and d orbitals, outermost NS electron become inert. That's why they can form the plus 3 increase down the group and plus 5 decreases. Here also due to inert pair. So plus 6 oxidation number decreases, plus 4 increases. So I can write here polonium rarely form plus 6. It cannot exhibit plus 6. Okay. Next, electron gain enthalpy. Electron gain enthalpy is normally down the group. It has to down the group, the property actually that should be decreases. Down the group actually decreases. But here if you observe these two are somewhat different. Nitrogen having the small electron gain enthalpy or electron affinity. Why it contains small electron affinity? Due to small atomic size. due to small size, nitrogen can exhibit has the small electron affinity. Thereafter, it is a normal regular atom that is decreases. Here also sulfur to chromium it is decreases, but this is we have one exception: small electron affinity or less electron affinity. I can write it less electron affinity due to small atomic size of oxygen. Here also this is contained less electron affinity, that is due to the small atomic size of nitrogen. Okay. So next I will discuss about the trends, hydrides trends. Now let us see the hydrides. Okay, hydrides. Three five properties I am going to discuss here: stability, melting point, boiling point, bond length, bond energy, and reducing property. Now stability, you see, which is more stable among the hydrides? Ammonia. Ammonia more stable. And stability order decreases. Why the stability order decreases among the hydrides of 15 group elements? Due to decreasing bond energy. Bond energy means what? Amount of energy required to break the bond. As down the group atomic size increases, bond length increases. When bond length increases, amount of energy required to break that bond also decreases. So due to high bond energy, ammonia is more stable. And due to less bond energy, this for the hydride is least stable. Next to water from H2O2 tellurium. Okay, if you observe 16 group elements, water same like this. Water is said to be more stable here. Why it is more stable? Same reason, due to more bond energy. Bond energy always left to right, what happened? Decreases. When increase and due to increase in atomic size, bond length decreases. So bond energy also decreases. So this way I can explain about stability of the molecule. Among all the hydrides, ammonia is more stable, bismuth hydride least stable. Here water is more stable, tellurium is less stable. I am not discussing here polonium hydride because polonium is a radioactive substance. Next, melting point, boiling point. Melting point, actually melting point directly proportional to metallic nature. Melting point directly proportional to metallic nature. Boiling points are directly proportional to intermolecular forces. Intermolecular forces. Okay, you have to always remember that melting points are directly proportional to metallic nature, and we can also say to be the cohesive forces. Cohesive forces are responsible for the melting points. Okay, boiling points directly proportional to intermolecular forces. You observe one point here. As I told you, down the group from nitrogen to bismuth, metallic nature, what happens? Metallic nature always increases. So due to increase in metallic nature, okay, due to increase in metallic nature from nitrogen to bismuth, melting points increases. I mean increasing melting point order. Okay, I repeat once again. Down the group, metallic nature increases. When metallic nature increases, melting points increases. So melting points increasing order I written. But here you have to understand about the ammonia. Ammonia is not, why it is not less stable, less melting point? Here written everything is normal, but here we have an abnormal order. Ammonia is not having least melting point because ammonia, it contain intermolecular hydrogen bonding. Due to intermolecular hydrogen bonding, ammonia having little bit more melting point comparing to phosphine and arsenic hydride. Okay, similarly boiling point directly proportional to intermolecular forces. Intermolecular forces depends on size. Down the group, atomic size increases. When atomic size increases, intermolecular forces increases. I mean, van der Waals forces increases. When intermolecular forces increases, boiling points also increases. So I written boiling points increases. Here also ammonia having, I written more boiling point. Why ammonia having more boiling point here? Due to intermolecular hydrogen bonding. Due to hydrogen bonding. So due to hydrogen bonding, they having the more melting point and boiling point. Here also you can see hydrogen sulfide, selenium hydride, tellurium hydride, water. Same point I can explain here. Metallic nature increases, melting point increases. I written and intermolecular force increase, boiling points increase. But here again, water is exceptional. Water is having highest boiling point, highest melting point, because this is due to hydrogen bonding. Due to hydrogen bonding, water having the more melting points and boiling points. So the exceptional point in case of melting point and boiling point. Bond length in hydrides, you can see everywhere element hydrogen bonding. So that bonding, how what happens? Nitrogen to bismuth hydride, that will be increased here. Why it is increased? Nitrogen to as antimony hydride, nitrogen to bismuth atomic size increases. When atomic size increases, bond length increases. Here also bond length increases. So again, I am writing due to increase in atomic size. When atomic size increases, by bond length between the element to hydrogen always increases. Next, bond energy. Bond energy inversely proportional to bond length. Bond energy inversely proportional to bond length. Down the group, bond length increases. Yes sir, down the group, nitrogen to bismuth atomic size increases, so bond length increases. When bond length increases, bond energy what happens? Decrease, because both are inversely proportional to each other. A simple point. When the bond is very long bond, it is easy to break, it can easily break. Whereas bond is very short, difficult to break. Okay, that's why short bond length containing bond always having more energy. We need to supply more energy to break that bond. Whereas longer bonds require less energy to break it. Okay, so both are inversely proportional to each other. That's why I written this is decreasing order. Here also same. So bond energy inversely proportional to bond length. Next, last one is reducing property. What is reducing property? If I take the ammonia, ammonia having 3 bonds. Bismuth also having the 3 bonds. Bismuth hydrides, they are having the 3 bonds. Element to hydrogen bond. Reducing property means they have to give one hydrogen. Reduction, what is reduction? Addition of hydrogen. Addition of, when they can give the hydrogen here? When the bond is very short bond, does they give hydrogen easily? No, they cannot give the hydrogen easily because there is short bond. Whereas if I take the bismuth hydride, due to very large bond length from bismuth to hydrogen, they can easily give the hydrogen. They can easily give the hydrogen. Whereas nitrogen to hydrogen bond, very short bond, so it cannot lose hydrogen that much easily. That's why I write it here, ammonia is mild reducing agent. Mild reducing agent. Whereas bismuth hydride is strong reducing agent. Okay, so ammonia is mild reducing agent and bismuth hydride is strong reducing agent. Because nitrogen hydrogen bond length is very short, it cannot give the hydrogen easily. Whereas bismuth to hydrogen bond length is more, it can give the hydrogen easily. It is difficult to give, it is easy to give. And here also sulfur to tellurium reducing property increases. Water, except water, except water, all are having reducing property. So this is strong reducing agent. Okay, why it is strong reducing agent? Down the group, always element to hydrogen bond length increases, they can do the hydrogen easily. Okay, next we'll continue the properties. Basicity order. Basicity order, what is the basic? Lone pair donor is said to be base. Lone pair donor is said to be basic compound. Here nitrogen to bismuth, nitrogen having lone pair of electron, phosphorus having lone pair of electron, all are having almost lone pair of electron. Okay, in this hydrates. But which can lose lone pair of electron easily? Which can transfer lone pair of electron easily? If you see the nitrogen being a smaller atom, it has one lone pair of electron. Bismuth is a bigger atom, it also having one lone pair of electron. For a smaller atom, electron density will be more for nitrogen. You have to understand here, basicity also directly proportional to electron density. So understand this term, electron density. Which is having more electron density, that becomes more basic. Smaller atoms always having more electron density, whereas larger atoms are big atomic size containing atoms having less electron density. In this case, ammonia smaller atom having more electron density acting as strong base. So this is strong base. Okay, understood? I repeat once again. Base is nothing but lone pair donor. All are having lone pair, they can donate easily. But the point is base directly proportional to electron density, which can having more electron density that becomes more basic. Nitrogen being a smaller atom, always smaller atom having more electron density. Bigger atom having less electron density. So I written ammonia is strong base, bismuth hydride is a weak base. Weak base. Next, 16th group. In 16th group also, if I observe the acidic nature, this is not basic nature, don't get confused here. Acidic nature. Acidic nature always down the group increases. Why acidic nature down the group increases? Due to decrease in bond energy. Due to decrease in bond energy. Whenever bond energy is decreased, they can easily do the H proton. Okay, water, hydrogen sulfide, hydrogen selenide, hydrogen telluride, which can give H plus easily. Water having hydrogen bonding, it cannot lose hydrogen H plus easily. Whereas tellurium and all, selenium, more atomic size and more bond length. When bond length is more, bond energy less. When bond energy is less, they can easily do the H plus. Whereas for water, more bond energy required. When more bond energy is required, they cannot do the H plus easily. Okay, so that is nothing but which can do the H plus easily. Based on that, we have compared the acidic nature. Water cannot do the H plus easily because of small atomic size and intermolecular hydrogen bonding. Whereas hydrogen telluride, due to more bond length and less bond energy, it can easily lose the hydrogen. Whereas in oxides, I am discussing here two types of oxide, E2O5, E2O3. E2O5 is said to be more acidic. This is less acidic. Why this is more acidic, E2O5? Because if you observe oxidation number, oxidation state of element is here plus 5. Here it is plus 3. Okay. For example, if I compare the P2O5, P2O3, which is more acidic, P2O5 is more acidic. You always have to remember that whenever element having more oxidation number, that type of molecules are said to be more acidic. Here phosphorus having plus 5, here phosphorus having plus 3. That's why P2O5 is said to be strong acidic. In E2O3 particularly, which are given NCERT, N2O3, P2O3, these two compounds are one category. They are said to be basic arsenic oxide, antimony oxide. These are said to be amphoteric, but our last one is bismuth oxide is said to be acidic. Okay, understand this. I'm talking about the E2O3 type. In E2O3 type, N2O3 P2O5 acidic, because N2O3 P2O5 are made up of non-metals. Nitrogen, phosphorus are non-metal. Non-metallic oxides are basic. Sorry, this is acidic. Non-metallic oxides are acidic and metallic oxides are basic. Yes, I'm sorry about that. Okay, so nitrogen, phosphorus, both are non-metal. Non-metallic oxides are acidic. And arsenic, antimony, both are metalloids. Metalloids here I'm writing as amphoteric. Whereas bismuth oxide, being a metal, bismuth is a typical metal. So metallic oxides are said to be basic. And E2O3 to EO2. EO3 nothing but which is having the plus 6 oxidation state. This is having plus 4 oxidation state. So already told you which is the element which is having more oxidation number, they are said to be more acidic. So this is said to be more acidic. This is less acidic. For example, if I take the SO3, SO2, which is more acidic? SO3, because sulfur dioxide having plus 6, sulfur dioxide having plus 5. Okay, that's going to be said to be more acidic. And EO3 type of all the oxides of the 16th group elements are said to be acidic. All are acidic. All oxides are acidic in this nature. Okay. Next, last one is halides. Halides E5, EX5, EX3 type. EX5 is said to be more covalent in nature. This is less covalent in nature. Okay. Here also the oxidation number it is +5. Here oxidation number is +3. The element which is having more oxidation number, it is said to be more polarizable. When it is more polarizable, more covalent nature. Covalent nature directly proportional to polarizability. Directly proportional to polarizability. Okay, which is directly proportional to oxidation number. When oxidation number is more polarizable, they are said to be more covalent nature. That's why EX5 type is more covalent. For example, I will take an example here. PCl5, PCl3. Among these two, which is more covalent? PCl5 is more covalent because this is having the more oxidation number, so that it contains a more polarizability. Whereas in EX6, EX4, EX2 type, these four, of course, which is having more oxidation number, there is more covalent nature. So EX5 is more covalent, then EX4, then EX2. Here, particularly these three examples, I have to discuss some structures. Example here, I explain about SF6, here SF4, here this is SSCl2. Okay, these three important structures I will explain here. I hope it is not clear, it is clear about these two. This is not clear, SF6, SF4, SCl2, that I will draw the structure. Here, if I take the SF6, SF6 in the sulfur oxidation, I already told you how to find out the hybridization. Previous video, if you observe, I told you hybridization, how to find out this P plus M minus C plus K by 2. Here, sulfur group number is 6, number of monovalent atoms 6, there is no charge, is equal to 6. 6 means sp3 d2 hybridization. Okay, here sulfur having sp3 d2 hybridization. When sp3 d2 hybridizations are there, the expected geometry is octahedral. So sulfur, which is having 4 bonds here, this is SF6. Here no lone pairs on sulfur. No lone pairs on sulfur. If lone pairs are not there, there is no distortion in the geometry. There is no distortion in the structure. Okay, so geometry is octahedral, hybridization is what? sp3 t2. Okay, similarly, if I take the SF4 and SSCl2, SF4 here, oxidation number, hybridization is P plus M minus C plus K by 2. Here, sulfur group number is 6. How many monovalent atoms are in SF4? Which are having single bond? 4 by 2 is equal to 5. 5 means sp3d. But here, sulfur sp3d, 4 bond secondary. But still, sulfur having one lone pair of electrons. I can write like this, sulfur having one lone pair of electrons. So, whenever lone pair of electrons are there, geometry is always distorted. This is distorted trigonal bipyramidal. Trigonal bipyramidal. So this structure also said to be like this. If I draw the structure without lone pairs, into mentioning the orbital lobes, this is said to be seesaw structure. Seesaw geometry. So how many lone pairs on sulfur? Lone pairs and sulfur is equal to 1. 1 lone pair will be there. Here lone pairs are 0. No lone pairs. When lone pairs are absent, structure or geometry will not be distorted. When lone pairs are there, structure will be distorted. See, that's why then distorted trigonal bipyramidal, that can be written as seesaw structure. And last one is SSCl2. SSCl2, the hybridization can be taken as sp3 hybridization. You can find the same formula, you can get the sp3. The geometry is SCl2, but it has 2 lone pair of electrons. So this is said to be bent structure. Bent structure. So lone pairs on sulfur is equal to 2 lone pairs. Lone pairs in sulfur is equal to 2 lone pairs. Whenever sp3 hybridizations are there, the expected geometry tetrahedral. But this molecule will not exist in tetrahedral because it has 2 lone pair of electrons. Okay, these are three important structure halides: SF6, sp3d2 hybridization, octahedral. Lone pairs are 0, that's why structure is not disrupted. In SF4, hybridization is sp3d, sp3d. So expected geometry is trigonal bipyramidal, but this molecule having one lone pair, so it becomes distorted trigonal bipyramidal. So that's why the structure will be seesaw structure. Lone pairs on sulfur is equal to 1. Whereas in SCl2, the hybridization will be sp3. In sp3, the molecule will be having bent structure. Actually, sp3 means it has to be tetrahedral, but due to lone pairs, the presence of lone pairs on sulfur, the structure will be distorted. The distorted structure can be taken as bent structure. Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel.